Hello, my name is Faris and this is Animated Anatomy. In this video, I will talk to you about the nose anatomy and the nose job. If you're a patient who just wants to make his nose pretty, or you're a student who wants to learn how to do it, you're in the right place because here you'll find all the information you need. I do this because I love this job, and I'll make sure in the first half of the video you first understand the nose anatomy, and then we can move on to actually explain you the nose job or the rhinoplasty. That's why you should watch the video till the very end. I don't know whether I should first talk about the anatomy of the nose or the nose job. I guess to understand the nose job, I will first have to explain you what actually is the nose from the anatomical point of view, so that you can understand how to make a pretty nose. Now, whatever the reason you're watching this video for, whether you're a medical student or any kind of student or just a patient waiting for the procedure, you will get your information right here. However, at the end, I made a small surprise for those students who are learning because they have to know the details. I made a small quiz where I will question them details. Now, the visible part of the human nose is this protruding part of the face that bears the nostrils. The shape of the nose is determined by the ethimoid bone and the nasal septum. And the nasal septum can be seen here. It consists mostly of the cartilage, but there are other structures inside that I will show you that also create the nasal septum. Now, before we get into explaining you all the structures inside and how it works, I'll show you two things, what's up there and what's down there. Up there, you have the nasal bones right here meeting the frontal bone. And this part is called the nasal root. There's also the nasal floor down there, and you can see it here, and it's created by the palatine bone, and here you should be able to see also the premaxilla, which is basically a bone on the tip of the upper jaw. Now let's remove the maxilla and the frontal bone. I remove the frontal bone, I remove the maxilla. Let's remove the brain and the nerves as well, so we can see the bones clearly. Well, not just the bones, but the cartilage as well. This right here is the lateral nasal cartilage, and this right here is the major alar cartilage, and you also have here the minor alar cartilage. So, you're a patient, you want to fix your nose. Which part is not good? Which part looks bad? Take a good look at the profile of your nose from the front and also from down below, and you can analyze which part you want to change. Now, I want to remove these parts because here I don't want to do the surgery and fix it. I just want to remove it so we can learn what we have inside more. Before I continue to explain you what we have inside more, I want to tell you that you have some hair right here, and if you're female, you have a little of the hair, and if you're a male, you probably have more. Also, males have bigger nose generally. Generally, they have a bigger nose than females. Now, remember I have mentioned the nasal septum. Here you have this quadrangular-shaped structure, and that is the cartilage of the nasal septum. Here you have the vomer bone, and here was the palatine bone. These three structures, along with two extra structures, this right here is the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone, right here. Maybe it's better if I don't select it, but basically this plate right here, in the median part of the ethmoid bone, and I should remove the lacrimal bones here and here, and then I should remove the nasal bones as well. You should remember that I have mentioned the premaxilla down there. Also, some parts of premaxilla create the nasal septum. So basically right here you have the parts of the palatine bone as well creating the septum, and the vomer bone, the cartilage part, and the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone. Now, before I explain you the nose job and how to make a pretty nose, there are things I left I want to explain you, and in order to explain you these things, I will have to create the frontal section of these bones right here. So here you can see these weird structures. They look like some kind of bags or even aliens. Well, that's partially because they do look that way, and it's partially because they were modeled badly. Now, these badly modeled structures are actually conchae, and you have the superior one, the middle one, and the inferior one. They're the bony frame of the tuberates. The turbinates have space here, the meatus space between them. And space is also named corresponding to the turbinates, basically the superior one, the middle one, and the inferior meatus space. Now, what do we use our nose for? I mean, we can smell some nice food with it, a perfume or hot girls. I mean, we're not going to run around smelling hot girls like some kind of stalkers. I mean, we will, but we'll do that later. Now, I want to show you actually how this process is done, and I'm going to remove the frontal bone again. And here you can see these holes right here. Now, these holes are here on this plate that is called the cribriform plate, and that is part of the ethimoid bone. And through these holes, you have the sensory filaments of the olfactory nerve passing down and sensing the smell. So this is how you smell something, and these signals are saved in your brain. They go to the emotional part of the brain, like the limbic system. I made a video about limbic system in my software. And these memories, they can be saved for years and years, and they can come from early childhood to a really old age. And you can, for example, not smell certain food or certain perfume for years and years. And then when you smell this perfume, if it's specific to a certain situation that you have learned in early childhood, you will instantly remember it. The smell will be so familiar. You might not even remember the situation, where does it come from, but you will be able to remember the smell. So this is one really important, also from the psychological point of view, it's tightly connected to the limbic system. And it's really important for example, mother and child relationship. When the baby is born, the first thing that the kid should smell is the mother. So when the synapses start to create, the kid immediately smells the mother. And subconsciously, it does affect the relationship in the future between the child and the mother. Now you can also imagine what kind of influence this has on the love and the person you love, and if that person used a specific perfume. It can also have a lot of influences on the food you like. If you were ever really, really hungry, for example, the people who really disliked a certain type of food, for example, they never like to eat eggs that are old and smell bad. If they're ever starved nearly to death, and then they're given these badly preserved eggs that smell bad, they will feel this as something good because they're really hungry. And this will remain in their memory for a very long time. They will always feel nice, even if the egg smells bad. They will not get bored by the bad smell of an egg. Now, enough of talk that sounds like a bunch of gobbledygook. Let's stick to the nose job and the surgical procedures and basically cutting and taking out and putting in here grafts and, you know, the simple stuff. So the rhinoplasty, or more commonly known, the nose job procedure, dates back to almost 3,000 years before Jesus was born in the old kingdom of Egypt. The obsession with having a pretty nose has been around for thousands of years. If you look at the Greece and Roman statues, you will realize that many of them have extremely straight noses, which simply does not reflect the population of any race or population on the earth whatsoever. It is similar to Hollywood celebrities today being role models for us. So the nose job is not always about making your nose look pretty. It's also about correcting and reconstructing the form of the nose in case of a trauma or an accident. It's also about restoring the functions. There are basically two types of surgeries, the closed rhinoplasty and the open rhinoplasty. It can be performed by an otolaryngologist or maxillofacial surgeon, or also a plastic surgeon. So the surgeon will basically cut the skin off your nose, and it will separate it from the cartilage and the bony part of the nose, and it's going to correct that part, and it's going to attach the skin back to your nose. As I previously said, there is a closed rhinoplasty, which is performed by creating the incision at the base of the nose and all the way through the nostrils. However, there is a closed rhinoplasty, which only includes creating the incision inside of the nostrils, so there is no visible scar after that. So normally what you would expect from a nose job procedure is that you can fix the size and the shape of your nose. Also, you can fix the span of the nostrils, and as well, for example, the angle between the upper lip and the nose. I will explain shortly how to fix two really common problems. That is the dorsal hump and the two wide nostrils that are often common. So in case of a dorsal hump, the surgeon will simply remove the part of the bone or the cartilage that is not wanted. It will be taken out and then he will close the wound and suture it back. In case of a too wide tip of the nose, the surgeon can actually remove the part of the nose that is creating the tip of the nose, and that is the alar cartilage. After removing the portion of the alar cartilage from the nose, the surgeon can suture the alar cartilage more tightly and make it look more pointy. In this case, after it heals, the nose tip will look much smaller. Normally, after the surgery, you can return back to your work and normal activities within 3 weeks. However, some nose swelling will appear even up to 6 months after the surgery. Now, for all the professionals and medical students out there, I will do a small quiz now and you will be able to test your knowledge. So stick with me. You should answer these questions and the questions will appear on the display. If you click correct answer, you will move to a new answer. If you click to the wrong answer, it will send you back to the part where I explained that. And if you don't click on any answer, nothing will happen. So in order for this quiz to work, you really have to click at some answer. It doesn't matter if it's right or wrong. So let's start with the anatomy of the nose, and I would like you to click at the correct name of this structure here in the middle. And now I would like you to click at the name of this structure right here. So this structure right here that I'm showing with my cursor. Now you should be able to tell me which structures create the nasal septum. Okay, so far so good. I would like you to click at the correct name of the nerve right here innervating the nose. And you should click at the name of the plate that it's passing through. And now I want you to click at the name of this bone right here. And I would like you to tell me the name of these three structures that you can see here. So I hope you're happy with my nose anatomy and nose job video. In my next video, I will talk about the cranial nerves. You can watch that video here. You can also watch my previous video here. If you want to purchase my very own software, then you can go to my website animatedanatomy.com. If you don't want to purchase it, then at least you can subscribe here for new free content that I release regularly on my channel. Thank you.
Thank God, deshalb mo nam zaina tamski, ona chana tamski de pauzira.